Let's look at an example of a Welch t-test and confidence interval. The Welch procedures are a version of the t-procedures in which we do not pool the variances together. Does a certain rattlesnake antivenom given after a rattlesnake bite have an effect on swelling? Researchers ran an experiment to investigate this in pigs, randomly assigning pigs to one of two groups. A treatment group, which received an antivenom, and there were 9 pigs in the treatment group, and a placebo or control group, which received a saline solution, and there were 8 pigs in this group. The pigs were then injected in the leg with rattlesnake venom and either the antivenom or a placebo. And as a measure of swelling, we're going to use the change in volume of the leg after 8 hours. A large change in volume corresponds to a lot of swelling. And these are the box plots for the antivenom group and the saline group. And I've put in red dots representing the value of the sample mean. There doesn't appear to be much of a difference in the means. Is this a significant difference? Well, it doesn't look like it, but we should investigate that more formally. One thing we can notice here, it does appear as though the swelling in the pigs and the saline group had a little more variability than that of the antivenom group. Here we will use inference procedures to investigate the value of mu1 minus mu2. Here mu1 represents the true mean of the antivenom group, and mu2 represents the true mean of the saline, the placebo or control group. And in experiments like this, people sometimes call this difference the treatment effect, and they might label it with a symbol like delta. The Welch T procedures assume normally distributed populations, and we should always investigate that assumption. It's especially important here since we have these small sample sizes of 9 and 8. Recall that the points in a normal quantile-quantile plot will lie in an approximately straight line if the data is approximately normally distributed. I would say that these points lie very roughly in a straight line. It's always sketchy using these T procedures for such small sample sizes as we have here. But since these normal quantile-quantile plots look okay, I'm going to grudgingly give these the check mark and say that it's reasonable to use the procedures here. The antivenom group has a sample mean of 203.33, and the saline group has a sample mean of 201.25. And we can see over here that the sample standard deviation of the saline group is about double the sample standard deviation of the antivenom group. And we saw that difference in variability in the box plots. The Welch procedures do not assume equal population variances. So the fact that the sample standard deviation of one group is about double the sample standard deviation of the other is not a big deal. But if we wanted to use the pooled variance T procedure, which does assume equal population variances, a difference of this size would start to make us feel a little uncomfortable. We need the standard error of the difference in sample means, as that's going to appear in our confidence interval formulas and the hypothesis test statistic. And you can pause this and verify the calculations for yourself, but we get a standard error when rounded to 2 decimal places of 44.00. Suppose that we want to find a confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2. Well, here are the summary statistics and the appropriate confidence interval formula. The only bit that we're missing is this t sub alpha over 2 value. And we've looked at this type of thing previously, and for a 95% confidence interval, that means the alpha level is 0.05, and the t value that we need is t sub 0.025. And we're going to find that from software or a t-table, but we need the appropriate degrees of freedom. Well, it turns out that the appropriate degrees of freedom are given by this slightly ugly formula. And we usually rely on software to find the degrees of freedom and the appropriate t-value. But if we put in all of our sample values, we would see that the degrees of freedom here are 10.011. And so the degrees of freedom are 10.011. And if we went to software with this value, or we simply rounded to 10 and looked it up in a t-table, we would find that this appropriate t-value is 2.228. And so now we can calculate our interval. The sample mean of group 1 is 203.33. Subtracting off 201.25, the mean of group 2, and we add and subtract our t-value of 2.228 times the standard error of 44.00. And this works out to 2.08 plus and minus 98.03. And we can see here that this margin of error is very large relative to the difference in sample means. But if we carried out this addition and subtraction, we would get an interval of minus 95.95 to 100.11. And it's just a complete fluke that this looks a little like that. We can be 95% confident that this difference, mu1 minus mu2, lies somewhere between minus 95.95 milliliters and 100.11 milliliters. Mu1 minus mu2 is the difference in the true mean swelling between pigs treated with antivenom and pigs treated with saline. Note that zero is contained in this interval, and so zero is a plausible value of this difference mu1 minus mu2. Or in other words, it's plausible that mu1 equals mu2. In fact, zero is almost smack dab in the middle of this interval. And so we have absolutely no evidence whatsoever of a difference in population means. But if that's our point of interest, we should investigate that more formally with a hypothesis test. Let's test the null hypothesis that the populations have equal mean change in leg volume. What should we use for an alternative hypothesis? Well, as is often the case, that's debatable. I would argue for a two-sided alternative hypothesis, since I think we'd be interested in a difference in either direction. We'd like to know if this antivenom reduces swelling, but we'd also like to know if this antivenom increases swelling somehow. Here are the summary statistics along with the t-statistic. And the t-statistic is equal to the difference in sample means, 203.33, minus 201.25, divided by the appropriate standard error of 44.00. And when rounded to three decimal places, this is equal to 0.047. Let's see what that looks like on the t-distribution. Here's the t-distribution with the appropriate degrees of freedom of 10.011. And our value of 0.047 is right around there, 0.047, right in the middle of the distribution. For this alternative hypothesis, values far out in the right tail or far out in the left tail give evidence against the null in favor of this alternative. But our value of 0.047 is very near zero, very near the middle of the distribution, giving no evidence against the null hypothesis. But we should quantify that a little more formally with a p-value. For a two-sided alternative hypothesis, the p-value is double the area in the tail beyond the observed value of our test statistic. In other words, here it's going to be double the area to the right of our test statistic. That is going to be our p-value. And if we go to software, we can find that the p-value is 0.96. If we went to a table, we couldn't find the exact value, but we could find out that the p-value is very large. We learned long ago that the smaller the p-value, the greater the evidence against the null hypothesis. And we have this large p-value of 0.96 here, so there is no evidence against the null hypothesis. There is no evidence of a difference in the population means of the groups. There is no evidence that mu1 and mu2 differ. But conclusions should be phrased in terms of the practical problem at hand. Here there's no evidence of a treatment effect. There is no evidence that, in pigs treated with rattlesnake venom, that there is a difference in the mean amount of swelling between those treated with antivenom and those treated with saline. In most cases, we're going to let statistical software do the calculations for us. It's going to be our job to choose the appropriate method of analysis and properly interpret the results. And here's the output from the statistical software R. Output from other packages will contain similar information. And we can see here that this test statistic, the p-value, and the confidence interval are all the same as what we got, just given to more decimal places.